While EMD was dominating the locomotive market, and GE would make its debut in the locomotive market, there are four other diesel locomotive builders that also served in North America. The iconic and historical American Locomotive Works and Baldwin Locomotive Works, the marine engine builder Fairbanks Morse, and the short-lived Lima-Hamilton, the same company that built many iconic steam locomotives. Each of these builders had varying degrees of success, some good, some not. And these four had their own reasons to leave the market. ALCO was defunct by 1969, Baldwin kept supplying parts until 1991, Fairbanks Morse moved back to marine engines before being bought out in 2020, and Lima-Hamilton left the business in 1956. While we have covered EMD and GE, let's dive into these four builders in this big video. The normal rule, no rebuilds, regears, or export locomotives will be counted here. Strictly North American soil and factory fresh. Nonetheless, I do hope you enjoy this big video here. This is every ALCO, Baldwin, Fairbanks Morse, and Lima-Hamilton diesel locomotive reviewed in 10 words or less. First dabble into diesels in a boxy style, with 40 more horsepower and seeing success in New Jersey. Curvy roofs for Long Island. Alright. Big boxy boy! But an underpowered failure. Funky ass center cab. Also clutter ass roof though. America's first successful road diesel. In a literal Chad. Prototype box cab, but with no cluttered roof. Decent. I'm sorry, but that long hood looks so goofy. A precursor to 600. Also that exposed equipment. Flat ass nose and underpowered, but a decent start. The proper start for ALCO, with a good switcher. The more powerful, but underproduced successor. Throwing in another 100, and a more stubbier nose. ALCO's entrance into the mainstream market, and they're a vibe. An obscure railroad's banger streamliner. Shame it's obscure. Black Maria never materialized anywhere and dead since 1947. A great success, but later topped by future switchers. Gaining cult following on short lines and industrial lines later on. The least popular out of the S's. But not bad. Canadian exclusives with moved boards and sandbox fillers. Not much distinguishable from the S2, aside from the trucks. Less horsepower for Boston. Chunkier and compact, and screaming Canadian blood. Modern hood and frame not jacked up. But still good. Slug moment. Kitbash looking ass and fitted with transition type controls. Longer frame, added short hood, and a little more packing. Now styling the more rounder nose, but these won railroad's hearts with 100 more horsepower. Canadian variant, but with a high hood because why not? Would you like your hood high or low, sir? Road switcher version with different trucks. Basically a C424 with a more stubbier nose. A humble approach to six axle road switchers, gaining a cult following internationally more than in America. And of course, Canada has their own mandated variant. Honey, I shrunk the six axle! For real, these are cursed. Adapted by the war, and again, international cult following. The cooler MRS switcher. Nothing more to say. Inadequate generator, another small footnote for ALCO's catalog. Better capacity in a solid six axle unit. Also C&W variant slaps. Elongated road switcher, with a high hood. Now smaller for lighter work. Sort of. Crikey mate, those are some giant alligators! Canadian-styled hood for your average Canadian variant. Flawed, but good response to the F unit. Of course, ALCO's first passenger variant. Another minor increase in horsepower with moderate success. CN's primary passenger ALCOs and backbones of tourist railroads. Classy passenger units, but not the most reliable. You want a higher low cab with your fries? A banger start for the four-axle centuries. The most Canadian variant. Very solid. Modern design for a 60s locomotive, but nothing more. Basically elongated and adopted for Mexico. More standard design, but with a smaller generator. Erie Lackawannas essentially had the same motors of the U-25Bs, rather short-lived for a more powerful successor. Unpopular for railroads, popular for rail fans, I think. A Chad when it comes to tractive effort. Beacle spec is hella funky of those built-in lights. Adapted for the Rockies, died in Mexico. ALCOs whimper out the locomotive market. International variants having a more cult following got me like a poor and ugly attempt for a diesel hydraulic.
ALCO, what were you thinking?
A great big rolling failure on wheels. A quiet start for America's dive into AC traction. Of course Mexico would be interested in exports. Standard or Canadian cab, best narrow gauge diesels in America. Amazing design, but riddled with problems. High reliability, eh? Ironic name, solid cowl, but an underwhelming finale. Forgotten attempt to high-speed rail. Maybe next time. Boxy, unusual, and a rough start for Baldwin diesels. That's a, interesting box cab, Baldwin. Very Dutch-looking, but interesting. Also, the New Orleans Hidden Belt Railroad and Hidden Baldwins. Early variants were interesting. The later ones are goated. Same situation here, but bigger and longer. Don't take that out of context. Now with confusing classification and an improved engine. Throwing more horsepower at the wall again. Adaptable for switching or in Cuba. Cal variant optional. Now including a thicker stack or without the turbocharger. Long hood for the front, low hood at the back. Throwing 200 more horsepower and a larger nose. Thick frames, toggleable number boards and radiators. Turbocharger bulge optional. Thicker underframes and later bigger hoods. Good improvements. Also horsepower. First road switcher and a decent first impression, I guess? Again with the sickening of frames? I question Baldwin. Smoother nose and weird spacing between the axles. Interesting combo. Calf. Simple increase of horsepower and... Sick Baldwin frames. Hooray. Calf! Again! Center cab giants are interesting. Also, EJ&E's goofy AF. The Pinsies look so... uncanny for some reason. When you make a diesel version of the big boy. Inconsistent build dates equals inconsistent design. Also, I feel intimidated. Would you like your single or double cab? Or shark cab? Half engine, half baggage, and half the horsepower. Short as baby! What happens when an F7 and an FA have a child? Great original cab, but where's the jaws? To me, it looks like an oversized sardine on wheels. Decent first arrival to the market, and in style. Reading always having their own quirky one-off. Again! Short frame, tall-ass hood, but a great diesel. Only change is the cab visor. Never mind. Dearborn's one-off hidden gems. For a Canadian variant, it is solid. Another low-E base design, and it's forgettable. Baby Trainmaster, at least for the later production units. Definitive baby units, and highly underrated. Final hurrah for the low-E inspired design. Peak Fairbanks with a dominating appearance. Submarine engines and a diesel locomotive don't mix that well. Sea liners are criminally underrated. Canadian Fairbanks are truly underrated. Powerful with a side of a Boco wheel arrangement. Fitted with third rail and capable of higher spin. Oh. Never mind. Literal fucking dollar store ALCOs and Baldwins. Well, we finally made it to the end of the video. I sure hope you enjoyed this installment of the 10 Words or Less series. The next big one I will be planning to do will be covering electric locomotives. I'm also considering doing one that's probably going to talk about the multiple units, but I want you guys' opinion. Should I cover EMUs and electric locomotives in one video, or cover electric locomotives in a separate video, and then tackle EMUs and DMUs in one big video? let me know in the comments below. The next 10 Words or Less videos I might have planned will be revolving around special interests and heritage units. You know, just because. Anyways, I do hope you enjoyed this video, and I will see you all in the next one. Take care, folks!